Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar series, where great professors teach you. My name is George Wilson, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled Unseen Diversity, The World of Bacteria. Your professor is Betsey Dexter Dyer, a biology professor at Wheaton College in Norton, Massachusetts, where her courses include bacteriology, genetics, parasitology, and invertebrate evolution. She earned her Ph.D. in biology at Boston University in 1984. Professor Dyer's research interests include DNA sequence analysis, cell evolution, symbiosis, and field microbiology. She considers herself to be a curious naturalist and a generalist with lots more to learn. She has written three books, including A Field Guide to Bacteria. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com. You can access this course by using the password 1121BDD. Again, that's 1121BDD. Once there, you'll have access to links to related sites, a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students, and yes, of course, a final exam. And now we begin Unseen Diversity, The World of Bacteria, Lecture 1, Introduction to the Bacterial World. And now, Professor Dyer.
This series of lectures is about bacteria. They are the most numerous of all organisms on Earth. They are the most diverse of all organisms on Earth. And they are invisible to our eyes. And that poses a particular challenge if we are to understand them. And it's a challenge that I enjoy dealing with and thinking about. And it will be an aspect particularly of this first lecture. I have several goals and aspirations for this course on bacteria. One of them is that I am hoping that you will come away from this recognizing that bacteria are most of the biodiversity on Earth. I would like to add a bacterial dimension to your nature studies, whatever they are. I certainly have a bacterial dimension to my nature studies. I'm a naturalist. I consider myself to be an amateur naturalist. I enjoy a walk in the woods in which I identify as many different things as I can. And I include bacteria, and I would like for you to consider including bacteria as a dimension to your nature studies as well. I think it is also important to place bacteria into the context of other microorganisms as well as organisms as a whole. That's another goal for this course. And finally, I'd like to put pathogens into their correct context. In fact, I have an entire lecture just on pathogens, but I will be alluding to them throughout because I think it's the pathogens of all the bacteria that tend to be getting the most press. Some of it is not flattering to them. It makes them sound as though they are the majority of bacteria, which they are not. And I think it's an important aspect of this series of lectures to get them into their context amongst all of bacteria. Now, the first challenge is that we have our own particular human point of view. And it does not get acknowledged enough, I think, in nature studies. We are actually anomalous compared to most organisms on Earth in a number of different ways, and that has an effect on the way that we look at things. So what I want to do is something a little strange for the beginning of a series of lectures on bacteria. I want to talk about ourselves as humans and why it is that we have a particularly challenging task to understand bacteria. First of all, it's our size. We are enormous. We are among the larger of organisms on Earth. Vast majority of organisms are microscopic. Vast majority of organisms are, in fact, bacteria, tiny, invisible bacteria, invisible to our eyes. So our own size is anomalous. We are enormous. We are also multicellular, which is unusual. Again, the vast majority of organisms are single cells. We are multicellular. That's how we get to be so large. We are highly morphological. We have shapes. We have structures. And we appreciate shapes and structures in other organisms. We are visually oriented. We can see color. We look around for other organisms that have morphologies, shapes, and colors. We also look around for other organisms that have activity levels and types of activities that are identifiable in some way to us or interpretable, whether we're right or wrong about that. We're looking for other organisms that seem to be in our same world. Therefore, we're wonderful at looking at birds and insects and mammals, other mammals. We have a great deal of difficulty with things that are much tinier than ourselves. We are terrestrial. We live on land, not any old land. We live on the surface of the land, and we tend to live in relatively temperate to tropical climates. And that does not get acknowledged enough, I think. Most of the world is aquatic. Most of the world is oceans. Most of the world is watery and deep. And that's not our place on Earth. We actually don't know much about the depths of the ocean, except in submersible submarines that some researchers have taken down to the depths, or except perhaps from dredgings that have been hauled up from the depths or nettings that have been hauled up. But for the most part, we're terrestrial surface dwellers, very small part of the Earth's surface, and that also has an effect on our appreciation for biodiversity as a whole. I don't think we have the full appreciation that we could ever have of what's going on in the aquatic part of the world, which is most of the world. Bacteria, by the way, are entirely aquatic. I want to add bacteria to your nature studies, and I realize it's a challenge for me as well as you. I'm a great appreciator of birds, of flowers, of mammals, of trees, of insects. I have field guides for all of those. And what I want to do is to make the bacterial world seem maybe not as accessible as those things, but something approaching as accessible as those larger organisms that we tend to appreciate. I want to say that the microbial world is not optional for understanding and appreciating biodiversity. If we want to understand what the biodiversity of Earth is all about, we have to include the bacteria. Yet, I challenge you to take an ecology textbook, maybe of the sort that you used in college, or maybe one that you can find in a library, nice, thick ecology textbook of the sort that an ecology course is taught from. Look up whatever keywords pertaining to bacteria or microorganisms or microbes that you want in the index, and find most likely in that entire book there are maybe only 3 or 4 mentions of bacteria or microbes or microorganisms. And that ecology textbook purports to be about all of the ecosystem, presumably the biodiversity of Earth and all of the interactions of the various organisms. Where are the bacteria in that? Notice if you do this, if you actually take a book and take a look at the index, notice how the bacteria are mentioned. There will be a couple of pages on the methanogens. Those are bacteria that produce methane. So that's important. Where is the methane on Earth coming from? It's only coming from bacteria. So bacteria have to be given credit for that, and therefore you find them in an ecology textbook in the index. You will also find bacteria in the context of something called fixing nitrogen, and I will go into much more detail about what that means in subsequent lectures, but only bacteria can do this thing called fixing nitrogen, and therefore they get credit for that in the ecology textbook. And they will also be part of a chapter on decomposition. What happens, for example, when a leaf falls to the forest floor or when a bird dies and begins to decay on the forest floor, that whole topic called decomposition, and they will be given partial credit for their role in that. Certainly fungi are important, and all sorts of detritus feeders are important in decomposition. But that will be it. Those will be the mentions in the ecology textbook. So where are the bacteria? So I have something to prove here, I think, in these lectures. I need to show you that bacteria are accessible. They are the unseen majority of organisms on Earth, yet they are recognizable if you know what to recognize, if you can decipher them in the environment. So those are the challenges ahead for me as the lecturer for this course. And to summarize my goals, I want to add a bacterial dimension to your nature studies. I want to show them off, actually. I want to not tell you about all possible bacteria. There are probably millions of species. I have to be selective here in a lecture series of just 14. So I want to show off some of the most versatile and interesting bacteria that have stories to them and that are at the same time ones that you might be able to see yourself if you were looking for them. And I want to place the pathogens in context again. I also want to say something about my own background in this and how I came to be interested in the topic of bacteria, particularly from this point of view of seeing them as a major aspect of nature studies and something that is more accessible than is obvious at first. Back in 1980, when I was a graduate student in biology, I had the privilege to be on a field trip to Baja California, Mexico, with a group of some of the best field microbiologists in the world. It was part of a field microbiology course. And up to that point, I was respectful of bacteria. I certainly encountered bacteria in my PhD studies and in my master's degree studies, and even before that in some work that I did as an undergraduate in college. I was not especially interested in them. They seemed tiny, which is obvious. They lacked morphology, which is obvious. And they were not as interesting as other things that I might see under the microscope, some classic things that you know from introductory biology classes, perhaps, paramecium scurrying around under the microscope, or amoebae, and other things that are really on a larger scale, nonetheless microscopic. So up to that point, up till 1980, in this field trip that I got to take, I was not especially enamored of bacteria, and I certainly did not see them as being especially accessible. There on that field trip, I saw field microbiologists, specialists in all different aspects of looking for bacteria out in the field, out in the wild, picking up bits of scum and slime and flocks and sniffing them and feeling the textures of them and examining the colors of them. In some cases, even taking little tastes. There was absolutely no danger of pathogens out there. And some of these field microbiologists were European and accustomed to doing a bit of tasting in their field studies on some circumstances. And at that point, I had this vision of a field guide to bacteria. Now, I was a graduate student amongst other graduate students. I had no thought that I would be writing a field guide to bacteria or that I would ever become involved with this sort of topic as I am now. At that point, as a graduate student, I whispered to one of my fellow graduate students, one of these people should write a field guide to the bacteria, because I could see it as being possible. They were picking up bits of scum and slime and sniffing them and tasting them and examining the colors and saying, I know what group of bacteria this is, and I know what the relationships of these bacteria are to the other bacteria in this environment. By the way, Baja California, Mexico, the particular place that we were in was almost entirely bacterial. It's the area we were in was a very deserty, salty area where larger organisms do not thrive, especially in the midst of the highest salt area. And it was a real microbial paradise. And so we were standing out in the middle of this in the blazing hot sun, surrounded by bacteria, none of them pathogens, absolutely none of them pathogens. Never a thought about that, essentially identifying them in the field macroscopically without the use of microscopes. Well, years later, got my PhD, got a job, got a family, and found myself with some time to do some writing and ended up writing a field guide to bacteria. And it came out of essentially notes from experts in the field, experts who have spent their lives trying to identify bacteria in the field. And all I did was compile those together, essentially from notes, and thus came the field guide to bacteria. So that's how I come to be with this particular point of view about this, but also with a real understanding of the challenges of this whole field, that I'm not simply giving a lecture on how to go and identify birds or how to look at flowers. There's something on a different level here that I'm trying to do, and that's why I'm perhaps belaboring some points about our own particular point of view. So let me transition to what I call broad generalizations about bacteria, some of which are going to seem so obvious that they don't need to be stated, and yet sometimes it is the most obvious that should be stated so that we don't overlook it and take it for granted. So these are going to be some very broad generalizations, and then I will elaborate a bit on them and try to use those to help us to see bacteria in the context of biodiversity. One way that I sometimes think about this is that bacteria are hidden in plain sight, which is a phrase that I've stolen from the cryptographers, who might use a phrase like that to refer to some text that can be seen as long as you know the way to decode it, as long as you can use cryptoanalysis to decode it. So the text, the encoded text, is in plain sight. You just need to decipher it. And I think that is the way that the bacterial world can be taken as well. So here's the first generality about bacteria. They are the most numerous of all organisms on Earth. How numerous? Well, some scientists at University of Georgia undertook the calculation to figure out how numerous they are, and they came up with a number, an amazing number, which is 5 × 10⁰ power, 30. 5 × 10⁰ power. And when I talk to my students about a number that large, I say, this number is really beyond what we can easily imagine as large. When we say large, we might be thinking in terms of billions or trillions or multi-trillions, but even those numbers start to go out of sight of what our usual understanding of large numbers is like. So that's how many organisms there are on Earth that are bacteria, and they far, far outnumber any other organisms. And I'll actually give you the logic for why they far outnumber them. First of all, though, let's think about what those folks at University of Georgia had to do to get this estimate of 5 × 10⁰ as the number of living bacteria on Earth. Well, for starters, they had to consider every single cubic centimeter of all of the water on Earth. For example, they would take a cubic centimeter of water, and I don't necessarily always mean literally take that cubic centimeter. I mean consider a cubic centimeter of water in the surface of the ocean in the tropics, for example. Count every single bacterium in that cubic centimeter and then multiply by the surface area of the ocean in that particular area, tropical ocean, presumably either near shore or not near shore. And then do that again and again and again for the entire depth of the ocean, for the entire surface of the ocean. And remember, the oceans are the greatest part of the biodiversity on Earth. And get a number from that. Then they would need to take every single fractal surface of everything on Earth down into the depths of the soil where there are all these little cracks and crevices and passageways. Every single surface in and out of every organism on Earth, every animal, every plant, and by the way, that's the logic behind my saying that they far outnumber every single other organism on Earth, because they cover every single other organism on Earth. Take all of those numbers together, and they came up with this amazing number of 5 × 10⁰ power. By the way, there is another enormous amount of bacteria apparently circulating the Earth at all times in the atmosphere as tiny, tiny particulates, along with all the other particulates up there. I don't count those, and they did not count those into this calculation of 5 times 10 to the 30th, because it's not entirely clear whether those bacteria are doing anything active. They may be in a dormant state and may become active if they drop down onto Earth and get into a situation where there's something that they can do. So there's another dormant, huge population circulating the Earth at any time. This is a good time for me to say most of them aren't pathogens. 5 times 10 to the 30th, the vast majority are not pathogens. And again, there'll be a lecture entirely about that to really reinforce that particular point. So that was generality number one, most numerous on Earth. Generality number two, they are the most diverse of all organisms on Earth. And you could do this exercise yourself, either think it in your head or actually literally do it. What I do when I'm talking in front of a class is I stretch my arms up over my head and then to either side as though we are doing a great big stretching exercise. And I say, imagine this to be the family tree of all organisms, with my arms and fingers representing all of the branches of all of the organisms that live on Earth. And when I say all, I mean all of the animals, all of the plants, all of the fungi, all of the protists or protozoans, all of the bacteria. Imagine all of the organisms represented that way. The vast majority of that diversity is bacteria. And if you were to look for the fungi and the animals and the plants and the protozoans or protists, the other groups of organisms, they would be essentially off on their own branch. Oh, stick it off to the right side. It doesn't really matter where it is, but if you're trying to envision it, shoot your right arm out to the side and imagine that to be the branch that comprises all the rest of the organisms that are not bacterial. Now, how we figure out a family tree like that today is we use DNA sequences. So folks that have organized all of the bacteria on a family tree and organized the other organisms on that same family tree have gotten sequences for all of them. And it's the differences in the DNA sequence that allow us to say this or that organism is closely related, less closely related, distantly related, scarcely related at all on the family tree. And so this is a DNA-based family tree that I'm talking about, but it represents the diversity of what those organisms look like and what they do. And so again, I will say, on the family tree of all organisms, bacteria show the most diversity in respect to what they are all about, what they can do. So that was the second generality about bacteria. Third generality about bacteria, they are the most ancient of organisms on Earth. Their roots go back close to 4 billion years ago. So if you're thinking of that family tree, the base of that family tree is at around 4 billion years ago. And the other organisms, animals, plants, fungi, protists, or protozoans, branch off early, but they don't branch off with such enormous exuberance as the bacteria do, covering essentially all of the diverse possibilities of the family tree. So pretty much all of the major groups are starting back as early as 4 billion, but it's the bacteria that really diversify early and often at that point and from then on. So let's say I'm at a party, or let's say I'm talking to a group of students, and I want to talk about the antiquity of bacteria and all other organisms, and I want to put 4 billion into some sort of context. I will sometimes pace it off across the room. I will start at one end of the room, and I'll say, that's 4 billion. And then I will pace forward a little bit and say, this is the 3 billion point. And then about halfway across the room, I'll say, this is the 2 billion point. Then 1 billion, and then the other side of the room is the present. So I've got a timeline essentially that goes from 0 to 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 across the room. Or try this if you're in your car listening to this tape. You've got a dashboard in front of you. If you look at the midpoint of that dashboard, call that 2 billion years. Call the extreme left-hand corner of your dashboard 4 billion years and call the extreme right-hand corner of your dashboard the present, and you've got an entire timeline arrayed out in front of you. Okay, so if you can visualize that, let me tell you when various things were happening along that timeline. 4 billion years ago, that's the extreme left-hand side of the dashboard, or it's the extreme left-hand, perhaps, side of the room. 4 billion years ago, that's the origin of life. And in a subsequent lecture, I'll tell you a little bit more about why that seems to be a reasonable date for the origin of life. But right now, accept that is the origin of life at 4 billion years ago. And right away, bacteria began to diversify. So when I say bacteria are ancient, I mean their diversification began around 4 billion years ago. It isn't till about 2.5 billion years ago, so that's a little bit to the left of the midpoint of your timeline, about 2.5 billion years ago, that more complicated cells began to evolve, the kind of complicated cells that are our cells and the plant cells and fungi cells and protozoan cells. But it isn't till about 1 billion years ago. Now we're way over on the right-hand side of the timeline. We're over to the right-hand side of the room or the right-hand side of your dashboard. It isn't till 1 billion years ago that multicellular organisms began to evolve. And if we want to put ourselves, humans, on this timeline, well, we're essentially not on this timeline. This is a billion-year timeline. In every billion-year increment are 1,000 millions. And humans as a species started evolving about 1 million years ago. Therefore, if you pressed your hand flat up against the wall or flat up against the glass next to your dashboard, that might represent, that tiny, tiny space might represent the amount of time that we humans have been evolving. Rest of the organisms, the various animals and plants, started evolving about 1.5 billion years ago. So again, way over on the right-hand side of that timeline. So that was generality number three. Bacteria are the most ancient of all organisms on Earth. But there is something else about them that makes them, I think, especially intriguing, and that is you might be tempted to think of them as being a scaled-down version of all of the other organisms, almost as though you could put organisms on a continuum from enormous to large to medium-sized to small to tiny and see it all as an almost unbroken spectrum or continuum of sizes. And actually, that doesn't work with bacteria for some reasons that I think are actually quite profound and are helpful in our understanding of bacteria in general. And so I will continue that in the second lecture and begin with that point, which will be also a continuation of these broad generalizations about bacteria.
This ends Lecture 1. Unseen Diversity, Lecture 2, Hidden in Plain Sight, Part 1.
So we left the previous lecture with me beginning to explain what I mean when I say that we really cannot consider bacteria to be on a smooth continuum or a smooth spectrum of very large organisms to large organisms to medium-sized organisms to small to the tiny to the very tiniest, which are the bacteria, that it's not actually a simple continuum. Bacteria are really quite, quite different. They are not just tiny versions of large organisms, or perhaps the other way around. We are not necessarily large versions of those tiny organisms. I think of the continuum or the spectrum as a broken continuum. It's almost as if we're sliding along the continuum from large organisms to medium organisms to small-sized organisms, and suddenly we fall off the edge of a cliff and we're into a completely different world of the truly tiny organisms who are really doing things very, very differently. Here's another analogy that I think of mainly because I love dollhouses and I have dollhouses at home, and I sometimes think of the continuum of tiny things that you have in a dollhouse. In fact, you could even have a dollhouse within a dollhouse. One of the dollhouse children might have a dollhouse. So imagine all of the things in a regular house and then have them scale down to the size of what you might find in a doll's house, and then have a tiny doll's house within that doll's house, which in turn has tiny furniture. Scaling down on a relatively smooth continuum, and what I'm saying is you can't do that with bacteria. I say that you're scaling down and there comes to be a point where the continuum breaks and you're in a different world, a world where things are not simply smaller versions of whatever came higher in the continuum. That makes bacteria very intriguing, and it makes them a challenge. One of the many things that makes them a challenge, an interesting challenge, I think, for naturalists who want to incorporate them into their nature studies. So in the last lecture, we were in the middle of a series of broad generalizations about bacteria. I had told you that they were the most numerous. I had said that they were the most diverse of all organisms on Earth, and that they were the most ancient of all organisms on Earth. Continuing with those broad generalities, bacteria are also the most featureless of all organisms on Earth, especially from our human point of view when we are so oriented to other organisms that have morphologies and colors and activities. So bacteria are featureless, and I will even go so far as to say they are disappointing. Not necessarily disappointing to me now, but they certainly were disappointing to me the first time I ever saw them as a future biologist, as an undergraduate in college. And if you have ever tried to see bacteria under the microscope, you might know exactly what I mean. Let me remind you or tell you what that first experience is typically like. You have a microscope. You put a slide with bacteria, presumably on it, although you cannot see those bacteria. And you set that slide under a microscope, and you put the lowest power lens on it. You see nothing. You merely try to focus as best you can on some debris. Then you put your next most powerful lens in place. Again, you see nothing. And then you put your next most powerful lens in place, and at this point, you're probably magnifying things 400 times. You probably see nothing. You focus a little bit. If you're in a classroom, your professor comes over and looks in. You say, "Is that it?" Piece of debris. "No, that's not it." Your professor focuses a little bit for you, and at 400x, you see tiny, tiny dots and dashes. Maybe if the lighting is just so, and if the focus has been done just so. And it's disappointing. That's your first view of bacteria. Perhaps you go to the next higher lens after that, which will magnify things 1,000 times, and they're still disappointing. They're still tiny dots and dashes. And in fact, they're like little bits of punctuation. You could take the, you know, top register of keys on your keyboard, which are mostly your punctuation marks, and you could put little squiggles and dashes of various sorts and use the comma and the period to make some more punctuation, and you'd end up with the full range of morphologies of bacterial shapes. There's not much to look at. So they're not about what they look like. They are about what they do. And that's one of the reasons for the drop in the continuum, the drop off the cliff into a completely different world. It's a world of doing and not a world of morphology. So it means that we have to understand bacteria from the point of view of what they're doing. Now, this next generality about them relates to that. Here's the generality that probably does not need to be said, or at least it will sound as though it doesn't need to be said. Bacteria are tiny. Do I need to say that? Yes, because tininess has its own profound connotations that I think we can only imagine, because we ourselves are nowhere near in the position of being able to directly experience what it must be like to be as tiny and therefore as intimate with the environment as bacteria are, because that's one of the major consequences of being tiny. Bacteria are in a very intimate relationship with their surrounding environment, so that any little nuance, any little change of acidity or alkalinity or temperature or salt or moisture levels, any input or output from a bacterium that's right next to them, because after all, their environment is not just the physical environment, but it's also the other bacteria that are in the environment. They have an immediate and nuanced response to that. They are very quick to respond to any changes whatsoever, and that has great connotations for their relationships with the physical world. It's all about those responses, and it's all about putting chemicals out into the environment, taking chemicals in, and being responsive to whatever is going on in the environment, mostly in respect to chemicals. In fact, sensing chemicals is their major sense. It's their primary sense. It's very little of any other kind of sense that is in the bacterial world. We, remember, we're anomalously large. We anomalously large organisms can only imagine what that might be like. And in fact, try this little thought experiment. If there were some sugar sprinkled out on the tabletop, and if you accidentally rested your hand in it, nothing would happen, absolutely nothing. You might feel a little bit of granularity, but none of your skin cells would respond in any way whatsoever to that being sugar. They wouldn't taste it as sugar. They wouldn't smell it as sugar. They would not immediately leap into action and begin to digest that sugar for you, and it would be bizarre to think that they would. We are insulated from the environment for the most part compared to bacteria, and the only way that I can tell that that's sugar or sweet is to take it into my mouth and to have very specialized cells of mine taste them as sweet, taste the sugar granules as sweet. And the only way I can begin to digest it is to take that sugar in and put it into contact with very specific digestive cells. It's just one of the things about being multicellular and huge as we are. And it's a very, very different thing. The entire bacterium has these responses, hair trigger responses to whatever is going on in the environment. Another thing about being tiny is you can reproduce much, much more quickly. There's just less material to make a copy of, is maybe one way to think about it. And bacteria indeed do reproduce extremely quickly, so that their whole timeline is sped up in a way that, again, is hard for us to understand. There are some bacteria that can make copies of themselves in an hour or less, and others along the order of hours to days. If a bacterium is not reproducing quickly, it's probably because it is dormant. There's not enough nutrients around, in which case it's waiting for nutrients to show up, in which case it will start reproducing again fairly quickly. So we are anomalously slow in our reproduction. We are not sensitive at all in the way that bacteria are to our immediate environment. And therefore, we need to understand these things about bacteria in order to really get a feeling for who they are and to start to recognize them in the environment. By the way, I keep calling ourselves anomalously large. We are even anomalously large in respect to our fellow animals. Try this little exercise. Most animals are not vertebrates like ourselves. They are invertebrates. The vast majority of animals are invertebrates. And by the way, probably marine invertebrates. So invertebrates that are completely beyond what our usual venue is. The vast majority of invertebrates are arthropods. Those are the jointed legged animals that include the spiders and the crabs and the insects. Vast majority of the invertebrates are arthropods. The vast majority of arthropods are insects, and most insects are beetles. And most beetles are tiny, tiny. So most of a major group of organisms, the beetles, are much, much tinier. We're the ones that are lumbering around in our terrestrial way, in our huge multicellular way, completely out of touch through most of ourselves with our environment. We're the ones that are anomalous in this. So again, the real challenge is to overcome that, at least mentally, and to try to see the world in a bacterial way. Right now, I would like to make a point about the way I've been using the word bacteria as a term. I have been using it in a colloquial way, although it might not have been obvious. One of the interesting recent developments of the last 20 years, especially since so much DNA sequence is now available for us to sort out organisms of all sorts. One of the really exciting developments in the last 20 years is that all of the organisms that we used to consider to be just the bacteria are now divided into two enormous groups. So one of these groups continues to be called the bacteria, and the other group gets called the archaea, A-R-C-H-A-E-A, the archaea. And I will tell you that the terminology for these two new groups is challenging, continues to be challenging. There have been a number of other ways of referring to them that have been tried out and essentially dropped for a little while. The bacteria were going to be called the eubacteria, that's E-U, eubacteria, and the archaea were going to be called the archaebacteria, and that seems to have not been favored recently. Right now, it's the bacteria and the archaea. We don't really have at this point a good unifying name that is accepted by microbiologists everywhere for what we would call the bacteria plus the archaea together, these two enormous groups that used to be the bacteria. And so I am going to not deal with that very much in these lectures, except as needed. I am going to continue to use bacteria in the older way, in the older sense, to encompass these two new enormous groups, the bacteria and the archaea. And every now and then, I will say I'm specifically talking about the archaea. Now, who are these archaea? Why are they so different? Why are we stumbling over the terminology? Why are we in such transition over the terminology for them? The archaea are also tiny, single-celled organisms, very, very bacteria-like, also lacking in much of any morphology at all. Also, you could represent these with tiny punctuation marks if you wanted to represent them. Also very intimate with the environment, also rapidly dividing. And so, of course, they were lumped together with the bacteria. It's only their DNA sequences that help people to realize that they were really a very different group. Their DNA sequences are really quite different. So a way to think about this, it's 4 billion years ago, two enormous groups of tiny featureless organisms began to diverge separately. And the archaea were almost in a sort of parallel universe with the bacteria. So while the bacteria were evolving all of their various fascinating things that they do with the environment, the archaea were also evolving their own versions of all of those intimate activities with the environment. So I think of it as a sort of a parallel universe. They have many bacterial-like properties, the archaea do, but I think some of that is partly because we human observers are looking for that sort of thing. And we say, okay, there they are, tiny, featureless, they're bacteria-like. Based on their DNA and based on some of the things that they do in the environment, they really are a strikingly different group. So with that, I'm going to continue to misuse the word bacteria through most of these lectures in a colloquial way. I'm going to use it as sort of the old umbrella term for the two of them. And again, I'm just going to use the word archaea in particular circumstances where I think it could really help our understanding of things, especially when I talk about some of the really different things that the archaea are up to. In order to make the bacteria, and now I'm using it in that over umbrella generic way, in order to bring the bacteria into your nature studies, into anyone's nature studies, I need to make them seem accessible in spite of their invisibility and in spite of their very, very different existence, so different that they're not even on a continuum with us, in spite of their aquatic existence, which is a challenge for us as terrestrial organisms. Here's how I think about it. They are hidden in plain sight, but they can be deciphered. And there are plenty of field microbiologists who can lead you to their favorite bacteria in the field. If you say, I'm looking for a sulfate reducer, they can say, aha, I know exactly where to find a sulfate reducing bacterium, and I know exactly what it's going to smell like and what it's going to look like, and I can lead you straight to that organism, and I can even pick up a little slimy bit of it and show it to you. So there are a huge collection of observations from nature by individual field microbiologists, And all we need to do is incorporate those. I call them rules of thumb for identifying bacteria in the field. So what I want to do right now is tell you some of my favorite rules of thumb for identifying bacteria in the field. And I want to begin that with a disclaimer. These are not rules of thumb that I have come up with by myself. These are coming from all of the specialists all over the world who have as their specialty field microbiology and who can lead you to their favorite bacteria in the field, who can pick up a bit of slime or scum and examine the color of it and examine the smell of it and the texture of it and tell you what bacteria they're holding or what is the majority of bacteria in that particular little bit of scum or slime or flock. So this is really the rules of thumb for field identification of bacteria gleaned from specialists from all different subspecialties of field microbiology, all put together and made to seem like rules of thumb. And one other disclaimer that I want to make about this is that I am going to mix together the concept of field marks and the concept of habitats in a way that might at first seem a little disconcerting, especially if you are a field guide user. And I'm going to take birds as an example of a typical field guide use. It's going to seem a little disconcerting at first if you are a field guide user that I'm not going to make a great difference between the habitat of a bacterium and a particular field mark. But I'm going to try to convince you otherwise, and I'm going to try to convince you that, in fact, users of field guides to birds will do this as well. And there is an acronym that ornithologists have used for years in which they have borrowed from the United States military that I'm going to evoke here, and that is JIZZ, J-I-Z-Z. And it comes from a military acronym. Actually, the acronym itself is G-I-S-S, but it's been converted for pronounceability to J-I-Z-Z, JIZZ. And as used by ornithologists, it refers to the total of all of the characteristics of a bird that can be seen briefly, perhaps, on the fly, along with its particular habitat, all put together as one sort of total holistic observation of that bird that allows you to make the field identification. Now, what was the U.S. military doing with this particular acronym? It stands for General Impression of Shape and Size, G-I-S-S, General Impression of Shape and Size. And it was used by plane spotters in World War II who were scanning the horizon, trying to decide in a split second whether an incoming aircraft was an enemy aircraft or one of our aircrafts, presumably. And they were doing it on the basis of whatever sound they could hear, whatever color they could glimpse, even from far away, whatever shape they could see. And they were getting a general impression of it. Thus, general impression of shape and size converted to J-I-Z-Z for JIZZ. That's what ornithologists are doing. If you've ever been on a field trip with an ornithologist or a good bird watcher, you know that at no particular point do you have the bird in your hand, unless you're mist netting, but you're typically not netting birds and holding them in your hand. What you're typically doing is seeing a little fleeting glimpse, a flash of white, a particular way of flying, a particular way of getting into the underbrush, and in that complete picture, maybe a little squawk or a little sound, and that complete picture tells you what bird it is that you're seeing. That's the JIZZ of a bird. For example, if you saw a little flash of pink in a hedgerow at the edge of a field, and it was New England, and it was in the springtime, you might say, well, there's a male house finch, okay? What you would not do is run through a list of all the pink birds in the world one at a time. Is it a flamingo? No. Is it a spoonbill? No, you would not do that exercise. You would immediately zero in on male house finch because you're not just looking at the field marks, you're also looking at the habitat. So I will contend that even in a regular field guide, field marks and habitat are mixed together in a way that doesn't typically get.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.